All right, well, good morning, everyone. We're going to begin. Good to see a number of smiling faces this morning. Either you are really excited about this Sunday school lesson, or somebody got engaged. I'm not sure which it is. But glad to see so many of you here this morning and to see a lot of joy in the room. And I hope that joy will continue all the way through our service. All right, well, let's pray and we'll jump in. Heavenly Father, thank you for these people that you've assembled in this church, in this community at this point in history, and I thank you for the great privilege that we have to know you, to serve you. And I pray that today, through your Spirit, you would unite us in the truth and grow us in our understanding of the Word and our understanding of our identity as a church here in this community. So we just pray for your help and pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Well, today begins week one of a 7, maybe 8 week series that we're going to be taking a quick break from some things we usually do. And we're going to be answering some questions regarding several different words, theological words, descriptive words that help us understand who we are as a church. I'm often asked, and I've been asked by some of you in years past, I'm often asked today, so what kind of church are you? Say, oh, you go to Redemption Hill Church. What kind of church is that? And you might go, well, and a number of different words come to mind. Words like Baptist or Reformed or expository preaching or different things like that. And so what we want to do is just take several weeks and talk about a number of those different descriptive terms. And the hope is that for some of you that are newer, you will better understand who we are as a church. And for those of you who aren't new, this is a chance to clarify and to reaffirm really some core commitments and some core convictions that we hold as a church. So I hope that will be instructive for you. And the format is that I'm going to try to teach through all this in the next 25, maybe 30 minutes and leave some time for questions and maybe a little bit of discussion. So if you have questions throughout the lesson, jot those down and we'll have some time at the end to ask those. And if you have no questions, then we'll have a little bit of extra time to talk and fellowship before we begin our worship service. So the topic for this morning is, what do we mean by the word reformed? How many of you have heard that term, a reformed church, a reformed doctrine, or something like that? So that's a word that has a lot of different meanings. Are we reformed? Well, we first need to understand what that term means. So here's a bit of an outline, an overview of where we'll go today. I want to talk about what the word reformed means in terms of its historical meaning. There's a historical sense that the word reformed carries. We'll talk about that. Secondly, there's a theological meaning to the word reformed. What does it mean to be reformed theologically? We'll talk about that. What does it mean denominationally? There are such things as Reformed Baptist churches. There is the RPCA, the Reformed Presbyterian Church, right? So there's different denominational attachments that this word can have. And then we'll finally just talk about what reformed means practically for us here at Redemption Hill. So that's a bit of an outline and an overview. You don't have to take notes on that, but that's just letting you know where we're going and the types of things that I hope to cover this morning. So first of all, the historical meaning of the word reformed. Well, many of you know that the Protestant Reformation, something that took place about 500 years ago, was a key turning point in church history. Prior to that point, the church was one sort of entity, but it had become corrupted. There had been both doctrinal and moral corruption that had crept into the church, and there was a reformation, there was a turning point where a number of different key church leaders, as they studied Scripture and as they saw the true gospel, they realized that there either had to be a radical change within the Catholic Church, or they needed to withdraw. And so this was the Protestant Reformation. It was a recovery of the gospel. It was not something new. It was actually a return to what the church had originally been established on. So it was not inventing new doctrine as much as a rediscovery and a return to the truth of the gospel. It was a return to the authority of Scripture, to see that it is not any specific human leaders in the church. It is not even the traditions of the church that hold ultimate authority. It's the Word of God. It was a return to the authority of Scripture. It was a correction to corruption and error that had come to dominate the church. And there's a few different key leaders that were part of this. Many of you know about Martin Luther. He was the first reformer, not that he's the only one pushing back, but he was an Augustinian monk who nailed 95 theses, 95 statements, to the door of the Castle Church in Wittenberg, Germany, October 31st, 1517. And so this is often looked to as one of the key moments that sparked this Protestant Reformation. This was taking place in Germany. And this is not academic or biblical. I just think it's funny. So I'm sharing it with you. Here's a painting of Martin Luther. It says, "The door is fine, I'm just fixing your theology," okay? So I just laugh when I see that on Reformation Day every year. Thought I would bless you with it this morning. John Calvin was another such reformer. And he was not in Germany. He was actually a French pastor and scholar. And in 1534, John Calvin delivered a speech calling the church to return to the pure gospel of the New Testament. And the church leaders didn't like that. His speech was burned. He was in danger, so he fled Paris to go to Geneva. And in Geneva, Switzerland, is where he put down roots, and he pastored there. He trained other pastors, and you could do a whole study on what took place in Geneva. But John Calvin was influential in the Reformation that was taking place there. If you go to Geneva today, you can see this this statue. It's on the Reformation wall there in Geneva, and it shows from left to right William Farel, John Calvin, Theodore Beza, and John Knox. So a number of different reformers that were really influential in developing what came to be known as the Reformed faith. And there were many other reformers as well. Ulrich Zwingli, he was a reformer. Hugh Latimer, an English reformer. Martin Bucer, William Tyndale, another English reformer. Philip Melanchthon, John Rogers, Henrik Bullinger. These are all different names that were key influential leaders in the Protestant Reformation. So when we speak of the Reformation, when we realize it was happening in England and in France and in Germany and in Switzerland and all these other places, it's really proper to even speak of reformations, plural. God was doing something, and a number of these different men were popping up, and truth was being recovered, and the gospel was being reclaimed as the central truth of the church. And so when we talk about the Reformation, we're talking about that historical sense, what took place in Europe there in the 1500s. And as we continue talking about the historical meaning of Reformed and Reformation, really what came out of all of that was these five pillars. First would be the value of sola scriptura, this conviction, this commitment, that the only foundation is Scripture alone. Solus Christus, the only mediator between God and man, the only Savior, is Christ alone. Sola gratia, the only method, the only means for our salvation is grace alone. Sola fide, the means of this salvation is faith. So it's by grace through faith. Soli Deo gloria, the only ambition of the church and of believers is to be the glory of God alone. These are these five values, these commitments that came out of the Reformation, pillars of the Reformation. And we as a church, we find solidarity with what took place in the Protestant Reformation. We can trace our roots as a church back to those leaders, those reformers, the truths that they were fighting for and teaching and dying for. And we would want to commit ourselves to these same values that emerged out of the Protestant Reformation, the five solas as they are often known. We think that these truths are just as relevant and necessary and critical today as they were then. So when we're talking about Reformed, think the Protestant Reformation, these reformers that were leading this recovery of the truth and really charting an alternate path to where the Catholic Church was going. Think about those five solas, those pillars of the Reformation. But in a historical sense, out of the Reformation also came these different confessional standards. These confessional standards was basically these church leaders getting together and saying, okay, if we're stepping away from Rome, stepping away from the authority of the Pope, stepping away from all of their edicts, what is it that we believe? What is it that really explains who we are as a church? And there was these different confessions, these statements of faith that were developed and were employed to help define what the church believed. And the differences in these confessions were often geographical. Again, you had Reformation taking place in Germany, in Switzerland, in England. And so as they're doing that, these different pockets of leaders and churches were developing these statements of faith. And so when you talk about Reformed, what that word will mean to some people is that you subscribe to these historical confessions. There was the three forms of unity, which includes the Belgic Confession, the Heidelberg Catechism, the Canons of Dort. These are summaries of Christian doctrine that churches said, that's what we believe. That's what we confess to be true. This is what our elders and pastors will teach. This is what our members will affirm. These are historic statements of faith. Three forms of unity is what the Reformed Church came to embrace. There's a little different stream of this that took place in England, the Westminster Standards. Very similar. It's very complementary. There's a ton of overlap here. The Westminster Standards includes the Westminster Confession of Faith, the larger catechism, and the shorter catechism. This is what the Presbyterian Church came to embrace. And there was other groups that utilized these as well, not just the Presbyterians. There were various Puritans and Congregationalists and even some Baptists that used the truth that is contained in the Westminster Standards to formulate who they were and what they would believe as the church. For example, in 1689, there was a group of Baptists in London that said, "We believe 99% of what Westminster says, but we'd like to improve it just a little bit." So they kept the spirit of the Reformation alive, that value of semper reformanda, always reforming, and they updated some of the baptism and church polity things that are in the Westminster Standards. So some of this, your eyes might be glazing over saying, okay, there's a lot of history here. What does this have to do with our topic? Well, when you use the word reformed, in a historical sense, that word, that description has roots in the Protestant Reformation. It has roots in these values, the five solas, and it has an attachment to these confessional standards for the church. And there are churches today that take these confessional standards and adopt them as their governing documents, and it helps to define who they are. So I hope you can see where we're going, that we as a church have not embraced any of these standards as formal governing documents in our church. While we value them, we respect them, we appreciate them, we agree with much of what they have to say, we are not, strictly speaking, a confessional church in that when you become a member of our church, you don't have to subscribe to the Westminster Confession of Faith. If you were to become an elder of our church, you would not have to you would not have to go through the canons of Dort line by line and show that you agree and affirm all of those statements. So we're not a confessional church, strictly speaking. But when people use the word reformed, they mean it different ways. And just keep in mind, some people have in their mind, reformed means these confessional standards. Reformed means rooted in this period of church history. Reformed means these values. And we would say yes to much of that. So let's shift from talking about theologically and talk about what the word reformed means, or shift from historically and talk about what reformed means theologically. Just like there are these five values, the five solas that came out of the Reformation, there are also five important points regarding the doctrine of salvation that also were really galvanized, hammered out during the Protestant Reformation. And they are often known as the five points of Calvinism. But you will find these more broadly in Reformation theology. It's not just Calvin. And I would argue that Calvin was not teaching anything new. In fact, the five points of Calvinism were actually a response to five other points put out by someone else named Jacobus Arminius. And what Calvin did was say, this is what we've always taught. This is what we think the Bible says. We trace these things back to Augustine, an earlier church father, and back to Paul before him, and back to Jesus. So Calvin did not invent these. These are just summaries of what this stream of Christianity had been teaching and what they felt had always been true. And so these five points are often known by the acronym of TULIP. I don't love the acronym because I like to change some of the titles, but I'll just give you a quick summary. TULIP would be, first of all, the T stands for total depravity. This is the theological belief that all men are fallen and sinful, and specifically that they are unable to save themselves, unable to change their own heart, even unable and unwilling to believe, left to their own. So this is the doctrine of total depravity. The U stands for unconditional election. Unconditional election is the biblical teaching that salvation ultimately depends on God's choice, God's work, God's initiative. You can go to the book of Romans, the book of Philippians. You can go in the Old Testament. You can go in the Gospels like John and find all of these places where Scripture teaches us that salvation happens because God in eternity past sovereignly chose whom he would save, and that this is an act of love, it's an act of grace, and because man is totally depraved and unable, if God doesn't do this, no one would be saved. So this traces all of salvation back to God's grace. These are often called the doctrines of grace. So U stands for unconditional election. The L stands for limited atonement, and this is one I would like to define differently. I prefer the label particular redemption or definite atonement. I like to describe it in a positive rather than a negative sense. But limited atonement basically says that Christ died and paid for the sins of those whom God had chosen to save. So rather than an unlimited atonement that said Jesus died for every sin by every believer and paid their debt so that some of them would then later go to hell and pay that debt again, limited atonement says that Christ died specifically for his own, that the shepherd lays down his life for the sheep, not for the sheep and the goats, that Christ loved the church and gave himself for her, for the church. This is the idea of definite atonement or particular redemption. The fourth point of what is often called Calvinism would be irresistible grace. And this is the teaching that when a sinner who is not saved but has been chosen by God, that when that sinner is going through life, there's a point where God is going to convict them of sin, the Holy Spirit, in order to fulfill what God planned and what Jesus died for, that the Spirit himself is going to open their eyes, illuminate the gospel, convict them of sin, and draw them to salvation. Irresistible grace teaches that God never tries to save someone and fails. That when God chooses to move on a soul, he always gets his man. He always gets the girl. He always accomplishes what his love and his grace intends to accomplish. That's irresistible grace. And then finally would be perseverance of the saints, which I like to call preservation. I also like to call irresistible grace effectual calling. I think there's some better terms for these, but the acronym's not as catchy, so we'll stick with TULIP for now. Perseverance of the saints is the doctrine that once someone is saved, those who are truly born again, who've been called by God, whose sins have been atoned for, who've been quickened and awakened and regenerated by the Spirit, that they will endure to the end. God will keep them and they will never fall away. They will never lose their salvation. Our eternal security is sure because salvation is a work of God's grace. It's not up to us and our wisdom or our effort. It ultimately depends on God. So when many people use the word reformed, oftentimes reformed is shorthand for having a Calvinistic view of salvation, for believing in these 5 points, or maybe 4 of these 5 points. Many people will simply use the word reformed not to talk about confessions or other things like that, but basically to mean, do you think God is sovereign over salvation, or do you think man's free will is what is ultimately determinative? So in that sense, people would say, is Redemption Hill Church reformed? We would say, in that sense, yes, we teach that salvation is God's work. And while there's mystery there and there's things that are difficult to understand and explain, we think this is the best explanation of the most verses in the Bible. This is the emphasis of scriptures that salvation belongs to the Lord. But there is more to Reformed theology than the doctrine of salvation. So while some people would use the word Reformed to describe your soteriology, your understanding of the gospel and salvation, remember, Reformed theology is bigger than that. So in terms of theological meaning, some people use the word reform to refer to covenant theology as the overarching system that traces God's work in redemptive history. Covenant theology is a way of explaining the whole Bible, not just the doctrine of salvation. And covenant theology really emphasizes, obviously, the biblical covenants, the covenant with Adam, a covenant with Noah, a covenant with Abraham, a covenant with Moses, the Davidic covenant, and the new covenant. The thing is, even people who aren't covenant theologians also believe in all these covenants. So full disclosure, I am not a covenant theologian, but I believe in the biblical covenants. But covenant theology goes further and really bases all of history on not just the biblical covenants, but theological covenants, what's often called the covenant of redemption, the covenant of works, and the covenant of grace. And these are things that are more inferred in Scripture. There are not places we can, there's not Bible verses you can go to say, there's the covenant of redemption, there's the covenant of works, there's the covenant of grace. They're deduced and kind of built as inferences from Scripture. And that's not wrong to do. However, I don't find their arguments fully convincing. So covenant theology is really a system of explaining the whole Bible. And this view, this theological system, if you embrace that, it's going to lead you to certain conclusions, and you can see now why we're not fully covenantal in this sense. Covenant theology teaches that the church has replaced Israel, or that the church is true Israel, the fulfillment of Israel, which is why they baptize babies, because you circumcise the babies in the old covenant in Israel. Why wouldn't we mark babies in the new covenant? And so there's certain continuities that they find between the church and Israel, and the nature of salvation that produces certain views of baptism, certain views of communion, certain views of even eschatology. And so while we can appreciate and benefit from much of what covenant theology teaches, and there's a lot of overlap, there's a few points where we as pastors and our church, what we teach would diverge from historic covenant theology. So again, to trace all this back to our big theme, what do we mean by Reformed? Well, we do mean that we believe in the five solas. We do find a historical connection to the Protestant Reformation. We do affirm the doctrines of grace, but we're not covenantal in our theology, and we don't subscribe to any of the confessional standards. So are we Reformed? We'll get to that answer in a moment, but you can see where that's going. There's also a denominational sense to the word Reformed. There are churches that embrace Reformed theology. Reformed denominations include conservative Presbyterian denominations like the PCA. Some of the more liberal Presbyterians, I think, have gone so far away from what those confessions teach that they're not truly Reformed in that sense. But there's many conservative Presbyterians out there, the RPC, the PCA, the OPC, some in the EPC. There's all these different streams of the Presbyterian Church. And the Presbyterian Church, historically, is Reformed. They subscribe to the Westminster Confession of Faith. They would affirm the doctrines of grace. They would be Reformed, ticking all the boxes. Covenantal theology, the baptism of babies, they are fully, thoroughly Reformed. And then there's others as well, like the Reformed Church in America, the RCA. They wouldn't follow the Westminster kind of collection of confessions. They would follow those other ones, the three forms of unity. But there are Reformed denominations. There's even some Baptists that are Reformed. Reformed Baptist, with a capital R and a capital B, there are Reformed Baptist churches that take the London Baptist Confession, this confessional standard from 1689, and they say this is going to be the governing document, our church constitution, and they subscribe to that. And they would affirm covenantal theology with the one exception of they're not going to baptize babies, they're going to baptize people who are spiritually born again, not those who are physically born in the church. And then there's some non-denominational churches that would be Reformed. They may not be connected to any of these formal denominations, but they would affirm all of this theology and be confessional. There are many non-Reformed denominations today. The Methodist Church, with its various branches, the Lutheran Church, even though Martin Luther was a reformer and the Reformation started in Germany, the Lutheran Church does not subscribe to those confessions, and it sort of has taken a different direction. And that may be confusing, but I've heard someone explain it this way. You might believe in democracy, but not be a Democrat. You could put it that way. They may have come out of the Protestant Reformation and may have a reformer as the founder of their church, but they're not Reformed in the way that the term gets used today. So Methodists, Lutherans, the Assemblies of God, Brethren churches, Nazarene churches, Wesleyan churches, some Baptists. Again, there's many Baptists that would say, we don't affirm the doctrines of grace. We reject covenantal theology. And they might push back on a number of places and say, we are not Reformed. They would be Arminian in their theology. So for instance, the Southern Baptist Convention, the largest Baptist denomination, it's the largest Protestant denomination in the United States, is a mix. You have some who are Reformed and some who are not in that big denomination. Most charismatics are not Reformed, and there's many non-denominational, you know, Bible churches, community churches that are also not Reformed. So when some people say, is Redemption Hill Church Reformed? You kind of have to ask, are they meaning that theologically? Are they meaning that in a denominational sense? Are they meaning, do we subscribe to certain confessions? And so we would fall in a non-denominational category. We're not formally connected to any denominations, but we do affirm much Reformed theology, though not all. So you can kind of see where we're going with the answer. Are we Reformed? The answer is yes and no. Yes, in this sense, we gladly embrace the values of the Reformation, the five solas. Those five solas are worth dying for. We would spill blood, our own blood, not other people's, but we would spill our blood for sola scriptura, solus Christus, sola gratia, sola fide, soli Deo gloria. We believe that those five values that come out of the Reformation are essential, they are urgent, and they are to mark and define the church in every age. We gladly embrace those values. We teach the doctrines of grace. We teach the sovereignty of God in salvation. We affirm gladly that salvation is the work of God. It depends on him. It is his initiative. It is his power. It is his will being brought to bear. And we embrace the spirit of the Reformation. We look back to the Luthers and the Calvins and the John Knoxes and the William Tyndales, and we say, yes, we say yes and amen. We thank God for those men, and we want to carry on their legacy and keep reforming. We want to take what they did, the spirit of what they did, returning to the authority of Scripture and upholding Christ and his glory, and say, how might that reform and change our church today? So we want to continue that. So are we reformed? Yes, in that sense. But the answer is also no, in the sense that we are not formally or fully reformed. We do not subscribe officially to any of the reformed confessions as governing documents. For example, when Stephen became a pastor and elder of our church, part of his examination was not going through the 1689 London Baptist Confession and finding if he would affirm or deny those various statements. While we value it, we reference it, it's a great tool. We see it as a systematic theology and a valuable piece of historical theology, and we're standing on their shoulders, but we've not formally subscribed to any Reformed confessions. We also don't belong to a Reformed denomination. So are we a Reformed church? Well, not formally in that sense, and not fully in the sense that we don't teach covenant theology with its view of Israel and the church, baptism, and eschatology. So yes, we're Calvinistic as a church, as leaders especially, but no, we're not. We don't subscribe to covenant theology. And what that means is that some people who do subscribe to everything that goes with Reformed would look at us and say, you're not Reformed, you're a bunch of semi-dispensational Baptists who are just Calvinists. And we go, sure. You know. So some of this, again, might feel like technical jargon to you, but these are real conversations that I am often involved in when people want to know what kind of church is Redemption Hill. And a key question always is, are you Reformed? And so I want to have this conversation out loud with lots of you because I have it one-on-one quite often. So that's a little bit of a summary of how I would answer the question, are we Reformed? In many ways, I would say yes, but in a few technical specific ways, no, not formally, not fully. How this impacts Redemption Hill Church. You might say, okay, what's the big deal? Why does it matter? How does this actually play out? Well, we do have a soteriological commitment. If you read our statement of faith, you will find in those distinctives a section on unconditional election. We as pastors are not agnostic on that. We both agree, and to be an elder at our church, you have to agree with the doctrines of grace, and we gladly teach it. We recognize not everyone may agree with us, and we're fine with that, but we also want you to know we're going to try to persuade you to see that we think this really is the best interpretation and explanation of Scripture. So there's a soteriological commitment in our church to the doctrines of grace. So you will see Reformation theology coming out in our preaching, in our praying, in our singing, in our ministry. You'll see Reformed principles at work in our worship. One of the key principles that came out of the Reformation is something called the regulative principle. The regulative principle. And what that means is that what we do in worship must have precedent, clear precedent in Scripture. And here's how I can maybe illustrate that. Because some people who would not affirm the regulative principle would say, well, as long as the Bible doesn't tell us not to, we have freedom to do it. I can't find a Bible verse that says we shouldn't have a clown on a unicycle juggling during the sermon. There's no Bible verse that says we shouldn't do that. The regulative principle says, well, there's no Bible verse that says that you should do that. So the regulative principle wants to say, okay, what we do collectively in worship as a church must have direct precedent in Scripture. So what you will find happening here at 10:30 a.m. every week is prayer, which we see examples of in Scripture and commands for in Scripture. The preaching of the word, which we see examples for in Scripture, commands in Scripture. Corporate worship and singing, which we see examples of in Scripture, commands for in Scripture. You will see the use of spiritual gifts to encourage one another and stir each other up. So you'll see things like the regulative principle. You'll see a high view of God, soli Deo Gloria. If the glory belongs to God alone, then we want everything we do as a church to be reverent and to lift him up and to put him at the center. You'll see it in our preaching. Sola Scriptura is going to come out in the elevation of the word. Solus Christus is going to be all over the place. The work of Christ is going to be celebrated and central in our church. And you'll see it in our practice of evangelism. If we believe salvation is God's work, then our job is to proclaim the truth, but we rely on the Holy Spirit to bring about conversion. We're not going to twist people's arms. We're not going to use emotional manipulation to try to get someone to come forward and make a decision, because we really believe that our job is just to get the seed out of the bag, to sow the seed, and it's God's job to bring the harvest. So you will see many practical implications of Reformed theology fleshing themselves out in our church. So this is not just something that, you know, is for seminary classes. We think this is practical and actually shapes the way we do church. And this is also just personally why, for me, if I were to not be a pastor tomorrow and have to move to a new city and find a church, I would want to find a church that was Reformed, in the sense of holding to the five solas and teaching the doctrines of grace. Because if they don't, it's not just that we might disagree on a few verses. It actually shapes the entire culture and the philosophy of ministry and the values of the church. It sets the direction and sets the tone. So we think these things are practical and important. So we've got about 15 minutes left. I know that was a really fast fly through, and we covered a lot of things. We covered denominational landscape in the United States, church history, doctrine and theology, our own philosophy of ministry. So there's a ton that's there, but I wanted to give a few minutes just for questions, anything that we could clarify as church leaders. Stephen's got a mic there too, so we might both chime in. But any questions, this is a good time just to ask those. Mandy. Okay, so the question is, child baptism, what does child baptism mean? That's a really big topic, but if I could try to simplify it, again, if you believe that the church and Israel are parallel, either that the church has replaced Israel as the people of God, or that the church is the fulfillment of Israel, and that Israel's kind of been absorbed and replaced in that sense by the church as the people of God. Then you look back on the covenants, and there's always signs for the covenant. There's always signs and symbols that go along with covenants. Even I'm wearing a ring today. That's a sign and a symbol of my covenant with my wife. So in the old covenant, the Mosaic covenant specifically, circumcision was the sign that someone that you belonged to the covenant community. And because that covenant was based on heritage, being descended from Abraham, it was represented by the males. They would be circumcised on the eighth day. And so they make a parallel between that and the church and say, how do we mark out who belongs to the new covenant? They would say baptism corresponds to circumcision. So they would baptize babies to show that they belong to the covenant community. And so where we would be different than that, the reason we practice believer's baptism is we think that while there are similarities between the old covenant and the new covenant is different and better. You can find that language in both the Old Testament and the New Testament. Jeremiah 31, Ezekiel 36, in the book of Hebrews, you'll find all these descriptions of how the new covenant is better than the old covenant. And one of the ways that it's better is that Jeremiah 31 says, they will all know me. So we think the new covenant, our theology would teach that the new covenant consists of believers only. Whereas Israel had a mix of believers and unbelievers. There was many that were circumcised, that fell away, were judged, were cut off. We believe that those who truly belong to the church, the new covenant, is a redeemed community fully. So we baptize people not who have been born physically into our community, as much as we love having babies here, but we baptize people who have been spiritually born into our community. We recognize that the symbol of this sign should only apply to those that spiritually belong. So we would see some disconnection, some discontinuity. There's a lot more to that. As far as the Reformed view of infant baptism, but that's kind of the quick summary. Yes?
And JD, would you say that then that sign of the covenant to a child, or even to a child's parents, to a baby, and as they grow up as a child, could give a false sense of security?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the question is, might infant baptism give a false sense of security to either a child or to their parents and reduce the urgency for conversion? Yes, that is a danger. And to be fair, the way we do baptism can also do that. If you baptize someone who's not born again, that's why we're sometimes a little slow to baptize. We want to meet with you. We want to talk through things with you before we do baptism here. So baptism in general can do that, but infant baptism, no pun intended, but it does muddy the water. It blurs the distinction between who's in and who's out. And I would just add to this that you won't find an explicit command or an explicit example in Scripture of baptizing an infant. It's not there. You will find explicit commands and explicit examples of baptizing a believer. So we think that it does bring some confusion when you practice baptism with infants. Yes? Yeah, I believe that's true in many of them. And just for the sake of recording, you're saying that many of these denominations, you have personal experience in them, don't require their members to subscribe to these confessions. I believe all of them do for their elders, and I think at least the RPC does for its members. In order to take communion to be a member, you do have to subscribe in the RPC, but that's unique among the rest. The OPC, PCA, EPC is more open with its membership, but their leaders all have to subscribe. Yeah, it's good clarification. Why don't you say what you want to say there?
Be the same.
Woo.
We would be similar in the sense that we distinguish in our statement of faith that for pastor, elder, you have to agree with 100%, whereas we have two sections in regards to essentials and distinctives. And so we would welcome people who maybe are differing on some of those distinctives, but we want to be open-handed with how we're, as a leadership team, teaching and leading and preaching in regards to the church. So yeah. It'd be similar here to what you've experienced.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Brady.
I don't know how to ask this exactly without speaking against any of the confessions because I think they are very good. But I'm wondering, like, with Scripture alone being, like, what the Reformed people hold to, and then having extra-biblical documents that are very closely based on those.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's a really good question. So how does the principle of sola scriptura, the people that really died for that often, why did they produce all of these confessions that are not the Bible? Well, I think if you were to ask them, they would say, this is underneath Scripture, and it is subject to the authority of Scripture. This is simply charting out how we interpret and apply Scripture. So they would say, it's the same as your statement of faith on your website. It's just more thorough and better thought out. That's what they would say to us. They'd say, you have one too. It's just shorter. You've created your own statement of faith. That's all they were doing. And by the way, I've heard some people say, how many of you have heard the phrase, no creed but the Bible? Have you ever heard that before? Some people would reject creeds and confessions and say, we have no creed but the Bible. The irony is, saying no creed but the Bible is a creed. So at some point, we just see these confessions, these creeds, statements of faith, systematic theologies, they're helpful summaries because error always comes in and seeks ambiguity so that it can sneak in false teaching. And so the reason that many of these things are nailed down the way they are is because they're reacting to challenges, to errors. Why is it, for example, that in our statement of faith, we have a statement about gender and sexuality? Well, it's because that's what is flooding our culture right now, and the church has been forced to defend the truth and explain, no, when you read those verses and say it means this, it doesn't mean that. It means this, and we're willing to stand on that. So that's what those creeds and confessions are. They're not meant to compete with Scripture or to be parallel with Scripture. Now, some people use them that way, but that's a problem with the person, not a problem with the creed or the confession. Some people will quote the confession more than they quote the Bible. And I think that's a missed opportunity. The confession is meant to be an on-ramp to help you understand and interpret the Bible. It's not meant to replace it at all. So, yeah, that's a really good question. Good. Any others?
Yeah,
Yes. Good question. So are babies, small children saved before baptism? And at what age do we recommend them being baptized? So there's a couple parts to that question. We believe that salvation is this big word. There's a number of things happening there. So let's talk about specifically conversion or regeneration, that moment where a dead heart becomes alive, where someone who was an enemy of God is reconciled and becomes his child, where the new heart is given and the Holy Spirit comes in, right? There's all these things happening at conversion, at salvation, regeneration. We believe that can happen with young children. But Scripture teaches that conversion takes place when there is repentance and faith. So a child who is unable to repent or believe because they don't have the cognitive abilities yet, we would not consider them saved in that sense. And so we would not baptize them. So we've had some young children here who have professed faith, and we've sat down with them as pastors because either they want to be baptized or maybe their parents want them to be baptized. And our practice here is that if a child cannot explain the gospel publicly, if they can't declare who Jesus is and why they believe in him and what that means and that they're a sinner, if they can't explain that, then they probably don't understand it enough yet. We're looking for evidence of saving faith and repentance. We're looking for grief over sin and a desire to change and good fruit going in a new direction. So it's hard to identify in a three-year-old. You might be able to identify it in a five-year-old or a seven-year-old or a 10-year-old, but they're all different. So we don't have like a rubber stamp age because every kid is different, every situation's different. I think the youngest one we've baptized, I'm trying to remember, is probably seven or eight. So we will baptize children on occasion, but we'll often encourage little kids who want to be baptized or parents who say, hey, my kid prayed and said they want to get baptized. We'll say, that's wonderful. Keep encouraging them. Keep teaching them. And if they're not able to, if we don't feel like they're ready for that, we'll just delay that. Because like you mentioned earlier, we don't want to give a false assurance because a lot of little kids just want to please their parents and they want to follow the crowd and fit in here. And so we don't want to mistake that for genuine saving faith. I don't know if you were asking about what happens to children if they never reach that point of decision and they die. Was that part of your question as well? Okay, so what about children? That's a long question as well. Did you want to add anything to the baptism part of that? I'll jump into that question. We don't have a specific proof text for that, but I do feel confident as a pastor giving comfort to people who've lost children, whether miscarriage, whether abortion, whether tragedy after birth, you know, something like that, the loss of a young child. I do feel in good conscience I can give comfort that those children are with Christ. And I base that on a couple of different things. One would be what we see David saying in the Old Testament. When he loses a child, he says that he will see him again. That's his anticipation. Also, I think on the character of God, would base it on that. In Romans chapter 1, it says that God is glorified, that his righteous wrath is displayed against sinners who reject the knowledge of the truth and suppress the knowledge of the truth. So in Romans 1, we see the righteousness of God, the wrath of God. God gets glory when he judges people who have suppressed the knowledge of the truth and refused to acknowledge what is written in creation and also what's written on their own hearts and their conscience. So it's hard for me to understand how God would be glorified by condemning forever to hell someone who has never suppressed the knowledge of the truth, has never rejected the glory of God in creation, has never rebelled against God in that sense. Now, children are still born sinners. They still have a sinful nature. So even if they've never actively rebelled against God, they're still, to use a biblical phrase, in Adam. They're still in this massive humanity that has a representative named Adam who failed. And so Adam's driving the bus and we're all in the back seat. That's just how it is for us. But this is where, for me, being a Calvinist gives me hope. I believe Jesus died to atone for the sins of those whom God chose. And so there's room for me in my theology to say God is glorified to choose and atone for Adam's sin and redeem these little babies and take them to heaven. I think that there's more glory for God that way, that there's going to be some human beings whose only conscious experience is the glory of God in heaven. And they will worship and marvel forever that though they did nothing, God saved them. And I think that will result for much glory for God. So there's more we could say about that, but I think Steve and I are both in agreement that we believe that young children, preborn children, or even people who have severe mental handicaps, we think God is glorified to save them. And because we're Calvinists, we think that there's room for that, because it doesn't depend on them praying or choosing or doing any of these things, that God is the one who's able to sovereignly do that. And we think that he's glorified that way. Sure. Craig. Sure. Yes. Sure. Yeah. Yeah. So Craig's just saying, you know, that point of limited atonement, see the merit of it, but you're wondering if there's more because of some of the language of the New Testament, whosoever will, or that Christ died for the sins of the world. Like, there's that sort of universal language there. So we would be very open-handed with that and recognize not everyone's going to be fully convinced. That's okay. That's the one point of the 5 points that requires, I think, the most deduction from what's clearly there in Scripture. I do think it's a necessary and valid deduction from what Scripture teaches, but we also recognize that it's difficult to fully explain that issue, and it's not something that we would be argumentative about or upset about if someone saw it differently. So, and again, there's room for people in our church to not be fully convinced of all 5 of those points and still be members and still worship here. So that's what I would say to that. And if you have more questions, this is probably 2 years ago, did a full lesson on limited atonement in our systematic theology class and sort of walked through some of those texts that have the universal language about the free offer of the gospel. And I do believe that we can, in good faith, offer the gospel to everyone. We don't go out and tell people, Jesus died for the sins of some people, and I don't know if you're one of them, but like, well, that's not how we share the gospel. We just say, Jesus died for sinners. And we invite men to repent and believe, because God, according to the book of Acts, now calls all men everywhere to repent. So we freely offer the gospel, and we think that the gospel, that Christ died for all, not exhaustively in an individual sense, but indiscriminately. So not all exclusively, but all indiscriminately, if that makes sense. He didn't just come to save the Israelites and the Jews. He came for people from every tribe, tongue, people, and nation. So it's a great question. There's a lot more to that. We are out of time. If you've got more questions, Stephen's available. I'm available. And I'm trying to remember what the topic is next week. I think it might be Baptist. So some of the questions we even got into today, we'll talk about more next week. So you're dismissed, and we'll see you back here in a few minutes for worship.